Hi, my name is Ankit. I head business development globally for Muvi. Muvi is essentially a technology company powering OTT. So anyone who's looking to launch an OTT platform, that's where we come into picture, and we give a completely end-to-end solution. So not just a video player, but the entire suite of product associated with that.
Hello.
I'm Nishant, Radia, and I'm the co-founder of Vidooly. We're a video intelligence platform. We drive actionable insights and work with content creators across different platforms, MCNs, brands, OTTs. Typically, anyone who's creating content or anyone who's looking to market content, we're able to tell you what the TG is watching and where to find them and where to target them. Getting an insight into what the audience wants to consume and what they've been consuming over the past years across different platforms. So that is where our expertise comes from.
Yeah, good evening. I'm Siddhartha, Laik. I'm the founder of and editor-in-chief of IWM Buzz. We are primarily into news, events, and originals. We cover the Indian television and web entertainment ecosystem. We create branded content. We have associations with UC News, Republic, other Facebook networks, etc. And we have our own IPs, the biggest being IWM Digital Awards. It kind of recognizes the best efforts in the web entertainment space. And that's it. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Pinakin, Thakkar. I head up Nirvana Digital. We're one of the larger multi-platform networks in Asia. We do digital distribution for original content, and we do a lot of syndication as well. We run approximately 250 channels on YouTube. We do approximately 1 billion minutes of watch time every month. Well, that's about it.
Hi, everyone. This is Amit. Sorry for the confusion. I was told there are 20 more minutes to go, and I was waiting outside. My background is I do two things. I run a startup called India Goes Global, which helps OTT products and other startups with their product strategy, content strategy, or business strategies. The idea is to grow 10x in impact in quick time, depending on where they are. I also run a startup called Okipoki, which is India's first kids app with a personalized learning experience. We use artificial intelligence, speech recognition engines to enable that.
Great. So while this panel is about, you know, Facebook's ambition to get into the video business, I think we'd like to first get an understanding of what is the challenge that, in terms of monetization, that, you know, multi-channel networks are facing. You know, what's the current situation?
Okay, firstly, we try and avoid using that abbreviation now. It's not multi-channel networks because we're YouTube enterprise partners and we're multi-platform networks. It's easier that way.
Yeah, that's also because YouTube's money is coming down.
Well, yeah, it is coming down on certain genres, and I think they're taking the right steps to go ahead and tweak this for us. Everyone is aware that there's a threshold now,
right,
that you can only monetize your channel if you are doing 1,000 subscribers, if you have 4,000 hours, etc.,
right,
which is good.
Right.
I mean, yes, it makes it tougher for the smaller players, but it's also great because the inventory allocation in terms from the advertiser is actually better.
Okay.
So the challenges that we face, yes, I mean, again, with the advent of Jio, our views have probably gone up 7x, 8x, but the monetization hasn't. Today, you know, the watchman and the liftman don't exchange content via Bluetooth or via SD cards. They're okay to stream it because they have a GB a day, which is a big thing.
Right.
So, the monetization in terms of, let's see where the ad formats go.
Right.
I think that not only MCNs or MBNs, even OTT players, everyone will have to figure out how to serve ads intelligently. That's all.
Okay. Anyone else?
I think since we're talking about Facebook, if I can digress a bit, we kind of work very closely with Facebook as content partners. Our first branded content was in association with Facebook. Now, Facebook, at this part of time, anyone can add also, primarily working on three ways of engaging with the clients. One is you have your content, they will give you a certain reach, but it has to be Facebook first.
Hmm.
After 1 week, you can put it on YouTube. This is what we did with Facebook. Second is they're working with a few partners, like Array and influences like Gaurav Gera, where they're doing the in rolls and mid rolls and figuring out how the ad monetization can be made more viable in terms of the quality of ad that's being placed, and also how the ad is more relevant to the content that is being put. That's where, you know, they're giving better numbers than YouTube at this point of time. Third is the commissioning model. When we first had a meeting with Facebook, they showed they have started commissioning certain fitness-based influencer content in the US. At this point of time in India, it's still growing, but they are working with news networks like Mirror Now Republic, where they're commissioning certain amount of money where the content goes stays with Facebook. So this is primarily what Facebook is working at this point of time, to my knowledge. And then maybe if someone wants to add up, you can add up, yeah.
Yeah.
So I'll look at it slightly. I'll take a step back because I'm not an NPN, erstwhile MCN, or an analytics play, etc. I don't work closely with Facebook, but largely I see a problem with people with huge content inventories across platforms. Is they also need to return money back to where this content factories produce content, either their own content factory or whether it's licensed, it doesn't matter. The primary problem happens on two areas. Either they're confused about what role each of these platforms will play in their lives, and that goes into the OTT domain beyond being a content owner or an MCN, MPN. And it could be, for an OTT play, it's about what's the role of Google Play Store in your life, or Apple App Store in your life. Sometimes people are very confused about what role are these platforms like YouTube, Facebook playing in your life. Second is sometimes they're too lazy to build in the right competencies to be able to do a better job of this. A simple example is when I see some of my friends who run MCNs, they have their primary revenue stream coming from YouTube. Okay? For now, assume like you have five revenue streams. Let's say, let's focus on one aspect of your business. For that business unit, it comes only from YouTube. Now, when you are building a platform business off somebody else's platform, right, like YouTube, then you're giving away a lot of your data and insights. And it's not like you're giving away and you get a copy of it. The fact is you get very, very limited data about your own content's consumer. And therefore, it limits a crazy amount of ability to do anything with that user base. So your channel subscribers are actually not yours. Your users are not yours. So that's what creates the dilemma.
So I mean, from what you're saying, essentially what you've done, Loki Poki, is you said, no YouTube, no Facebook, I'm making my own thing, right? Isn't that like literally the biggest, it's like, you know, trying to climb Himalayas and expecting, you know, miracles to happen?
Expecting you to catch me. But I'm not confused about the role of Facebook. We do use Facebook, but we use it as a marketing channel.
Sure.
We will not distribute our content on Facebook.
But today, I mean, I think someone like you, Nishant, who, you know, I follow your reports. It started with YouTube and now there are Facebook reports as well. Clearly, now there are two platforms here who are saying, we will help you. So Facebook is still saying, we'll show you numbers. We can't promise you money. And your report is all about who's number one. You know, I mean, of course it shows revenue numbers, but at the end of the day, for someone who's just creating content, right? So you have Muvi who can say, okay, you don't want to make the platform, I'll help you. And then there's Facebook and YouTube who's saying, I've got all the reach, don't make your own Muvi. So what would your inputs be on this?
So I think what we've been trying to do, even with those reports and stuff as well, is like Amit rightly said, the amount of content which is out there, no one's ever going to be happy. No matter how much Facebook monetizes, no matter how much YouTube monetizes, the quality, the way it's improved, no one's going to be happy with the revenues coming from the platform. It's only as a next step when e-commerce, brand integrations, and that piece comes into play, is when people are going to actually get the right buck for the content. And that is where limitations are there. So like Amit said, your subscribers are not your own. We're trying to then give these guys analytics in terms of helping them understand what their subscribers are consuming. So when you go to a brand as an OTT or as a YouTube channel with a subscriber, you know what your audience is and what is the type of influence you have on your audience. If you're able to depict it properly, I think branded partnerships is the only way where you can make money. And e-commerce still is a small part of it, but it started to grow. But I think branded partnerships and e-commerce is where eventually you'll be able to monetize your audience.
I think what Amit said makes, in one sense, I mean, if you're about building a database, you know, knowing who has access to your content, I mean, again, it's open for debate. Knowing who has access to your content is more important, or knowing how many people?
How many people doesn't matter. I mean, you can write whatever number on the slides, it doesn't matter. My honest submission is very simple, right? Either you become a content creator DNA, right? And be Balaji Telephones or Balaji TV producer, and you find a buyer for your content and make fat margins and be happy, right? Here is a digital opportunity why people are jumping into OTT spaces, because the entry barriers are low, or perceived entry barriers are low of getting in. Staying in, building a business is always tougher than getting in. And that's what's coming back to bite. If that makes sense, then what I'm saying is, the second competency is, will you actually directly interface with the user and therefore leverage that? The moment you change from here, a content creator factory, production house box, to building the last mile connection with the user, then all businesses are data businesses. All. Whether it's Flipkart, Amazon Prime, doesn't matter. Because if you cannot do an awesome job of that, and which is Nishant is laughing because I'm like, that's how I'll make my money, right? But all businesses are driven by data, because if you don't control your user information, their behavior, everything, right, you're losing every possible monetization opportunity out there on the table.
But if you think about it, one of the things that YouTube analytics, and I think social media, even Facebook analytics, talks about is, you can get an idea of, you know, who's watching, you know, referrals, devices, all of that. Possibly you just don't know the guy's email ID to send him an emailer, or, you know, you even know his, you know, which, I mean, who he is in that sense, you know, his handle. Yeah.
They give you what they give you, which is like a very, very tiny set of the information
you can collect. Yeah, but I think, I mean, the
Somebody who runs maybe like a bigger OTT play, if they're managing their big data like Hotstar, Woot, etc., And you've been part of like a lot of Hangama initiatives. So you would know where, to what level of data you can do,
sure,
and what kind of campaigns you can run to engage your user, to market something else to your user.
No stress. So I completely agree. I think YouTube gives us the data that, you know, I mean, every time they give us more data, we have to go with their vocabulary, right? It was views, it gave watch time, now it's intent. It's insightful for us, for sure. There's no doubt. But there's nothing like actually knowing and seeing the display picture of a person in front of you, which Facebook kind of does have an edge over in certain things. But again, I mean, Cambridge, the amount of data that has gone in the wrong hands, etc. We have to see where the balance gets maintained. Okay, today I cannot stalk. No one can stalk their college sweetheart or ex-girlfriend on YouTube, but it's possible on Facebook, right? So I think that the way that video is being consumed on Facebook right now, I was actually on the way here, I saw that 53% of the videos are the time point is 30 seconds and lesser, while YouTube has better watch times irrespective of whatever data both platforms give us, but it's interesting to see what kind of content will work on which platform. And that's how, you know, whether it's syndicators, whether it's creators, will decide that, hey, this platform is my voice, or this is where I can connect. Today, with YouTube has a community tab. They say, you know, we sometimes run opinion polls saying, what should we make next? So you get that interactivity. It's not like you don't, but I completely agree where the platform does control that. It's not like we get complete.
Ankit, someone like you will possibly say, you know, we give you access to all of that, so you don't need a Facebook, you don't need a YouTube.
Absolutely. So so I'd just like to come back to a point that Amit raised about the entry point, the entry barrier. A few years back, the entry barrier was the technology, and the content was very easily available. And that's why you saw a lot of users going and uploading the content on YouTube, rather than creating their own OTT platform. Now, there's been a complete switch, a 180 degree switch. Now the technology is very cheap. The content acquisition and the content creation has gone up quite drastically. So what is happening now is a lot of users or a lot of companies who had content on YouTube are now creating their own OTT platform to have better control. Over, you know, whom they can target, what they can target, how can they retarget. And there are a lot of analytics available to everyone if you have your own kind of OTT platform.
So if I'm a content creator and I come to you saying, okay, all I have is content, I don't know anything else. So would you come in and take care of everything?
Absolutely. So that's the space that we are into. What we are essentially trying to do is not to sell a technology, but we are trying to create this whole OTT ecosystem for anyone who's looking to launch an OTT platform and doesn't know anything about it, anything about technology, to have a very simple to use CMS. Just upload your content, select what monetization model you want, AVOD, TVOD, SVOD, or a hybrid, and then launch your platform. It's as simple as that.
But do you...
So I just have one question there, right? You'll be able to throw some light here. Because I feel the entry barrier is still tough. Monetization, sales, making money on an OTT is tough. So out of the inquiries that you get from how many people who want to create an OTT, how much of it is actually publishers and media houses versus, let's say, an individual channel who's crossed 2 million subscribers on a YouTube and Facebook? Are these guys also coming up and now thinking, saying that, okay, I need to launch an OTT?
Yeah, so we just recently signed up with a very big tennis academy. They have a YouTube platform currently, but they said the numbers doesn't make sense anymore for us. Plus, we don't know who's watching our content. You know, we know the demography, but we don't know exactly, let's say, Amit is watching my video, right? Or Pinakin is watching my video. I want to target them. I want to target them with more videos that I create, with more offers that I build out for them.
So coming back to what the topic is, Facebook, right? How do you think Facebook's going to get it right? And how is Facebook going to say, okay, YouTube has, I mean, there's so many complaints about YouTube. We'll sort their people's lives out and, you know, we'll try and build a video system or a video platform, which YouTube has not been able to achieve over the years. Anyone's take on it?
I've been a student of Facebook. I've hated it personally as a product, but I love it as a marketing platform. And they're a fantastic startup success story, right? Nobody can deny that. So when they launched their India program a couple of years ago, I was really, really excited because I could see the volumes of video consumption. There are two things that have happened and which disappoint creators in general. One is, corporate level, they've been facing a lot of shit on fake news and related data leaks, etc., sort of scandals, which diverts a lot of innovation energy back. Second thing is what I've realized by just talking to enough people who work with Facebook is, unlike Google, which bought YouTube and had an AdSense DNA for a decade and matured, Facebook does not have a partnerships DNA. At one level, they really care a damn. And they're trying to build that DNA because it's important for this business. They cannot produce everything that their users are watching. And DNAs, unfortunately, take longer to create. And as a big an ocean of consumption it has become, if you look at especially across Facebook apps and properties, you're looking at huge amount of consumption. But I think they're just taking way too long, either because of the corporate battles that they're solving right now, or just building that right partner DNA, they've not reached that level. I think they're far better job on the user side of managing demand, surfacing the right content, algorithms, and so on. I love all of that. But I'm still waiting because I'm on this side of the table, on the creator side, where I can see something magical happen where they can help us more.
So Siddharth seems to have actually had some success there. Can you give us some insight on how you manage that?
See, with Facebook, it's pretty clear. It's always what they want. You know, if you want to go and pitch them, this is the content I have, they'll say, listen, I don't want.
That sounds like a brand manager.
This is like, you know, this is what we want and work in these parameters. So there's a little dichotomy over here. There's one audience like us who understand we have to download an Ola, who's talking about data and statistics and stuff like that. There's also an audience, say, in a village in Bihar who has an access to Jio, but who's not willing to take that pain to go and download Hotstar and watch a match. Wo bolta hai, maine to already paisa diya, wapas kyun do? So this is where Facebook comes in. Understandable. Well, it's absolutely right. You know, when we last interacted with them last year, June, they said by September we'll crack this. They've not been able to crack it yet because Facebook works on a model of likes and preferences. So if you have a certain likes and preferences in putting an ad on that, when I share it, my likes and preferences change. The same ad may not be viable to your taste and preferences. And they are also willing at a model where it becomes a little bit of clutter-free. If you go to YouTube and see the top trending videos and you see the thumbnails and the clickbaity things, that is what Facebook doesn't want. That is where they want to charge premium for the advertisers so that they can pay out more. This is where, you know, they are pretty, pretty meticulous about it. Secondly, I feel today, where do you consume content the max? It's on the WhatsApp, right? Your articles, your videos, you hardly people go to YouTube. I mean, we're not searching anymore. Facebook has, the distribution is pretty sorted. The day they kind of crack the model, their idea, and end of the day, you go to group M also, they'll ask, achha, kitne views aayenge bata? Achha, kitne hits aayenge bata? CPM bata? No matter what you do, there's a certain sentiment that still prevail where they play on numbers. So the day Facebook can crack that model, of course I understand they have a certain way of working because they know, humare paas nahi to kahan jayega? YouTube se sab tang aa rahe hai because they are so brag about, they're not open to discuss their monetization models apart from some major players. You know, but Facebook also has a beauty of someone say, is uploading a video in a village in Bengal. So the awareness is not a problem. They know how to upload a video.
Yeah, I think it's a balance between saying, yeah, mereko sirf popularize karna hai. Paisa to waise bhi YouTube se bhi itna hi aata hai. It's like that.
So the reach is not an issue. The model, of course, is because they are very finicky about how they are going to be different from YouTube. Agar waise hi ad monetization dala, so they are not going to be different. That's taking time. Yeah.
Nishant, when I look at you and what you do as a company, you're pretty much in bed with both the brands. So what is your take on this? I mean, do you feel that, you know, they're thinking about the content creators, they're thinking about the consumers? Or because, I mean, someone like Facebook, we've seen the movie also, where initially wasn't ready to put ads and then you only see ads. But again, you're not as bombarded as YouTube with, you know, display and all of that. What is your take on both approach?
On Facebook, even the content creators are yet to figure out their video strategy.
Does it have to be different?
It has to be different. If you look at it, so we look at about 8,000 odd subcategory of content, out of which on Facebook only about 14 of them work well. So if you look at retention, watch time, those kind of metrics, it's just reach and it's just numbers. So that way, if Facebook starts monetizing and starts giving you a buck for your reach, then it's going to be chaos. So I think that needs to be figured out first as well, that, you know, what kind of content. That's why I guess they're also being very specific in terms of what kind of content they want, because they've done their research that this is the type of content that works. So I think that needs to be figured out. But once that has been figured out, I think creators are going to make more money than YouTube.
Have you seen creators who have worked equally well between YouTube and Facebook?
Yes and no. There's always 10 or 20% of top creators who just create amazing content, then the platform does not matter. But
is it a different edit or is it the same?
It's a different edit. It's generally a different edit. But let's say if you look at evergreen content like food, right? The top 10 food creators on YouTube are not the top 10 creators on Facebook. Only 3 of them are there, right? Because it's a completely different format of creating content. And we did this huge survey where we figured that, you know, on YouTube, they're looking at the recipes. On Facebook, the over-the-top short content works well. But all the top 4 creators which are there on Facebook, why they've become popular, and all of them are very small. The guys like Hebar's Kitchen, Jolly Food Fellow, they operate out of small places in Ahmedabad and somewhere. The only reason they worked well is because what they say in terms of saying that, you know, itna namak dalo, ye dalo, wo dalo, the end product is always the same. It tastes exactly like they've said. They've said it. It's not the same with everyone else. So every traditional creator from YouTube who's jumped to Facebook and started creating over-the-top videos, the recipes and all, it's just not resonated with the audience.
So just for clarity, the top 10 on YouTube, the same, or, you know, there are 10 people and you're saying they're the top 10. Have all these 10 gone on Facebook, but
they
not?
Have,
they
have.
They have.
They
but they've not achieved.
They've not achieved the feat which other creators have achieved. So I think it's also first more advantage with these creators have seen. And the audience is very different. So, just as a small example, 2 of the most popular stand-ups in India, right? I'll not name them, but both of them went to the US and did a show. Uploaded clips of that show on Facebook. One got a reach of about 1.2, 1.5 million views, the other got about 500,000 views. Now, the 500,000 views were completely organic. The 1.2 million views, there was some push in the reach. Now, when it was analyzed for the 1.2 million views, it performed like the retention rates were so bad that if I would have been that stand-up, I would never go to the US again. Except for Boston, where the retention was really good. So there's some psyche, there's some kind of a user base where that content resonated well. So I think from a metrics point of view, Facebook needs to evolve a bit and start focusing more on retention and watch time and all. Because the numbers like 3 million, 20 million, 30 million views, they're just deceiving.
So Ankit, when you say that you offer a kind of a 360 degree solution for content creators, how do you recommend social media as a part of the strategy? Or, you know, for example, do you suggest, okay, put up teasers on Facebook?
Yeah, so definitely. Because see, YouTube and Facebook will, they have the reach. You know, so they have the users already logging in every day and watching videos over there. So it makes sense to have the teasers, the preview videos posted on there. Maybe have a couple of episodes of a TV series posted on top, and then if you want to watch the rest of, you know, come to our platform.
I think Alt Balaji did something like
exactly.
That.
Yeah.
Do you personally feel that works?
Yes, it has worked for quite a few of our clients globally. Especially in a more mature market like US and Europe, you know, where they have done some experiments around how to kind of market on YouTube and Facebook by uploading just a small teaser. Yeah.
So, Pinakin, you run a distribution, business. Do you even bring Facebook into the entire gamut, or it's always like, hum yahan yahan monetize karenge, or, you know, I mean, is Facebook a part of your distribution offering?
That depends on who the client is, actually.
Okay.
So if the client is really finicky, then we'll say, okay, we'll only show him the monetization options first. But like you said, a lot of brand managers need numbers, right? So on YouTube, a view is computed differently, and I think he'll be able to help with this. In comparison to what we've been seeing on Facebook, which I think is the 3-second mark, it's still the 3-second mark, right? So yes, that's why, like you said, 30 million views, 40 million views, kahan ja rahe hain ye numbers? What's going on, you know? So it's good to get a reality check, but it's also nice to see those numbers. Monetization-wise, well, they did introduce a monetization program over here, they're doing a little bit of a trial, but it's, in comparison to YouTube, I don't think we're permitted to speak about it, but it's, I would say YouTube is on top right now. It's still the larger platform, and
it's like an open secret, everybody knows.
Yeah, so I mean, it's but Facebook does give you a lot of input when you need it, when you can't get it on YouTube. Maybe some of the OTT players have done maybe the first 2-3 episodes on YouTube and then moved on to their own platform. It's good for you to get analytics to play around with your campaigns on other platforms. Use YouTube as a data source, even though like we get X amount of data, but that data is also actually quite valid for you to make decisions.
Sure. So, Amit, in your case, if Facebook came today and said that, you know, I'm going to commission you, create content or create a parallel brand of Okie Pokie on Facebook, would you do it?
For the right terms, we'll do anything. We're startup founders, right?
Okay.
So there's no point being prudish about it. But honestly, Facebook is not looking for that, and we are a platform, so we're not a content creator, first of all. But lastly, I just want to push harder on the point which I touched upon earlier, and what Pinakin just mentioned about is there's a stat that I very, very often believe in. If you're making 100 rupees on YouTube, you should figure out your business is already ready, your content is powerful enough to figure out a 1,000 rupee revenue stream outside of YouTube. I'd be more than happy to catch up over coffee if somebody wants to really dig deep into their content, their channel or whatever. I can prove it to you. I can give you stories upon stories where we've done that. And which is why I said early on that either you're just confused what's the role of YouTube and Facebook in your life, or for that matter, Google search, which is fairly relevant for video, which a lot of people are not talking today because the topic is Facebook. But at the same time, you should not rely on them as your major revenue source unless they're commissioning content production to you, which can be really profitable. I think it's never been a better time to be a great quality content producer because there's so many people competing for your production capacity.
But, you know, one of the things that we experience also as a company is when you look at, I mean, today there are content marketplaces, there are players, I mean, we met a couple of people who are interested in syndication. But when you try to show them new content, it's always like, kitne numbers are hai YouTube or so. Everyone's always looking at somebody else making it popular and then saying, okay, then I'll put some money or I'll put some. So how does one?
Precisely the point, right? So build your brand on YouTube. So suppose you're a content factory where your job is like Excel Films to produce Inside Edge for Prime, and you want more Primes of this world to come to you. How do you get discovered by Prime unless you're already born with a rich brand and have a heritage of Bollywood, etc., to talk about you? So you go out, like an AIB was unheard of 5, 7, whatever, X number of years ago, or TVF, and you go out and build a solid brand using some of these global properties, and then let the money walk in and just cash it.
So what you're saying is YouTube and Facebook should be your marketing tools, not your monetization tools.
Yes, and take in the money they're giving you a few $1,000s, but just remember, the moment they're giving you $1,000, your content is already powerful enough to make $10,000 back for you. Why would you leave it on the table? Just pick up some competencies. It may take you a couple of years to get there. But don't let it go, and people like him are just helping you on that journey. Just go for it. And there are analytics providers who do a fantastic job on OTT. I was having a great conversation. I don't know if Anand has left from CleverTap. But they're doing a lot to make things simpler for you so that you control more aspects of your data.
So on that, just one thought, that is it then more about being a smart marketer on these platforms than about actually good content? Because now with geo and all, even if you go to the trending section of YouTube, there's a lot of...
create content all the time, right? So you have to be good at content. It's part of marketing function also.
But then if you look at YouTube right now, it's like there's a lot of content which is not quality content, but they've just got massive reach. So then it's more about, and if someone comes and wants to buy that content, it's more about just being a smart marketer than on content.
So don't get confused by small time metrics. It's very simple, right? Are you building your business for a long term vision? Or are you saying this month's numbers matter to me? Because first mover advantage, some bad clip got uploaded going viral and therefore getting picked up again and again by algorithms, very normal on any of these algorithm led platforms, right? Because these are not manual curation-led platforms, let's face it. So don't get confused by it, because that clip will have a shelf life, it'll eventually slow down, right? That clip might give a lift to a channel, and unless that channel improves the quality of content, which a lot of partner ecosystem has done, they started with horrible content quality, and they've just picked up, and moved to better and better. That's the right direction. Because eventually, you're going to be competing against more and more better quality content on any big platform.
But then you'll have to build a base.
No, it's not just that. What I'm thinking is, you know, while all the big players are already trying to figure out how long they can sustain, now you're saying, you know, the next guy who has, take an example of Dinchak Pooja. She'll build an OTT platform, thanks to Ankit. And we'll be hearing more of that content. So, you know, the reality is, isn't it a case of just giving control to anyone and everyone?
No, I'm saying these platforms survive on content creators. Let's just get that right. So they need us as much as we need them. Why do we need them? Because they've got the eyeballs. Now tomorrow I want to build my own IP. I'm a hot star, right? And I need traffic. I need to do user acquisition. Where will I go? I'll go to Google search. I'll do organic activities in the malls. I'll put up hoardings. I'll go to TV ads. I'll do Facebook, media, content marketing. It's part of that mix. How you use them is your comfort level as a marketer, as a brand, and you use it. Unlike life 3-4 years ago, so when you and I were discussing artists aloud first, the problem was traffic. I could not get users on my platform. I've tried Amit. Right? That problem is getting solved because of people like Muvi. It's easier to create, faster process, right? Much cheaper, right? Less product management headache to do, a lot of best practices are built in. Second is, you can acquire users better. Go to analytics solution providers who do OTT analytics like CleverTap, and they will tell you. Go to platform analytics providers like Vidooly, and they'll tell you how do you interpret that data better and plow it back into your strategy. All I'm saying is stop being lazy about it. You will have to do all of this if you want to be in the OTT game. So I'm just staying true to the conference topic also, that hey, we're trying to address something around the OTT ecosystem. Within that, it's a no-brainer. You cannot do without Facebook. It's so big. You have to have your strategy. You cannot ignore like 3 billion user platform.
But I'm not going to kind of take that as a summation, but in one sense, even if Facebook gets their act together on the video story, do you still believe, and this is about looking into the future, do each of you believe that Facebook will be able to create the next, you know, don't watch Star Plus, don't watch Hotstar, come and watch only Facebook, or will it still have to fight the fact that people look at it as a marketing tool?
We are fighting for mindshare as platforms, right? So they'll go through industry cycles. Now, Indians are very monogamous when it comes to their platform choices. There's one WhatsApp, there's one Facebook, there's one YouTube. You don't go to a Hotstar for YouTube-like content. They've tried it, didn't work, right? You go to Hotstar for Hotstar-like content. You go to a Wood for Wood-like content, and you have to define it. If you don't define that DNA differently, then you have to work with simple, bad principles like exclusivity. Somebody's going to hit me later, okay? But all I'm saying is exclusivity is a curse. You just could not figure your strategy out, so you took the easy path out, right? Have a cross-platform strategy, whether you use a platform for marketing, distribution, monetization or not, is totally in your control today. Because all these platforms cannot survive without you.
So, you know, the other thing to bring up over here is that YouTube and Facebook actually don't talk to each other really well. You know, I mean, if you run a campaign on Facebook, your reports are going to be different from what you would expect and what you'd see on YouTube. So if we can actually close that gap, it'll become more efficient. A multi-platform strategy is the first thing that you have to have. It's what you want to use for marketing, what you want to use for monetization. You can't move forward without that, right? For example, your Dinchak Pooja. Now, Dinchak Pooja, I think that she'd do really well on Facebook if she stopped doing everything else and just came on Facebook and probably just did Instagram, but it would work really well. Each platform will have their tone, and more importantly, it's the consumers. Like everyone is saying, the platforms can't survive without the content creators, but the people, the viewers, the end consumer is actually going ahead and defining what he comes to that platform for. And if you can dive deep enough into your data and create content like that, it has to work. It's not possible that, I mean, today we have a whole bunch of cooking people, okay, since we were talking about cooking, that are making 15-minute videos, 20-minute recipes, etc., etc. A bunch of people have made it into 30-second videos or 1-minute videos, put them into different languages, and they're only testing in that language on Facebook. I mean, Nishant will be able to help with that, but it, changing the language, changing the, you know, the, just doing the top shot like Tasty does, these are things that you can do because you're creating the content anyways, right? It's not like you're not making the expense.
See, I feel Facebook essentially will collaborate. If you see, Facebook doesn't, they don't have their own page where they put their content. So even if they're creating or engaging with partners with Hotstar, so the content will be put up on Hotstar page only on the Facebook page. Secondly, Facebook is known for the sharing platform. YouTube is where you watch, Facebook is where you share. Problem is that long formats have not yet worked on Facebook. Update to, you move out and you share in your world. This is where they're working on. Fourth, I believe if Facebook, as and when they can crack the code in terms of monetization and how they can collaborate and create that DNA that you mentioned, it will kind of give more options to people where YouTube's monopoly in terms of, you know, put it, we are the only ones who are going to pay you out, reduce. It's good for anyone who's a creator. Fifth, I believe it will empower a lot of people. How did YouTube become YouTube? Because someone who does not understand statistics, someone who doesn't know how the metrics of commissioning and pitching, someone who doesn't know Ajit more than Hotstar, but has good content, can upload on YouTube, and AIB became AIB because of YouTube. If similar can be done on Facebook, imagine the kind of new content creators that can happen from across India, which is good, which is not bad. Now, after you get that popularity, you get that initial eyeballs, which is now very difficult at initial phases where YouTube and Facebook helps, then you can go and play the larger game that you're talking. But if Facebook cracks the model and YouTube being there, God willing, more platforms will also come. It's good for content creators and it empowers India where, you know, anyways you're putting up a review on Facebook, if you get money for it, why not?
So Facebook has already done it's not a threshold, I guess.
If I may intervene, I have a friend, Gaurav Gera, he's with One Digital, Gurpreet. Gaurav tells me, I'm happier with Facebook at this point of time. Why? Because at times YouTube, you have to earn your views a lot. And it's a little pain at times. You know, after initial push, wo like organically hoga. Facebook tells you, okay, I have an advertiser. Okay, he's giving me 50 rupees. And the advertiser wants, say, 2 million views. Facebook tells me, you make this content for me exclusively, whatever, don't put it on YouTube, I'll give you that 2 million views also, I'll give you 50 ka 25 rupees also. So Facebook guarantees you that you make content for me, I'll give you the reach, which is in his hand. They can reach out to billion people with
this
reach.
But they're treating him as an influencer, so they obviously have, it's a paid model.
So that's the choice. That's the choice where, end of the day, he's getting money. End of the day, you're creating content and no one is watching it. You're not making money. And
nobody knows if that is actually being tailored or not. Nobody knows that. No, but the one question I had was, do you think the way now YouTube has, after a long time, they put this threshold which you mentioned about, you know, the 1,000 subscribers. Is Facebook going to open this up? Because Facebook is always, I mean, just when you look at the live feed as well, anybody can use it, right?
But not everyone can monetize it. Why did YouTube eventually put that threshold thing? Because Facebook is doing
that's
it.
That's what I'm asking.
If you are a content creator and you don't have that quality metrics, you cannot partner with Facebook, first of all. So that is where YouTube, anyone and everyone coming in, this is where Facebook has been pick and choosing. So everyone is not a Gaurav Gera to monetize it. He's a chosen one who falls in the parameters ke bhai aise karo, to aise hoga.
He's essentially saying that YouTube has a threshold, Facebook has an RSVP button. And if you're able, if you're just choosing...
Yeah, that's an interesting way of putting it, okay. Yeah. So, okay, I think we're done with the question unless any of you have any other inputs to make. Okay, so I think we're done.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you so much, Ankit, Nishant, Siddharth, Pinakin, and Amit. Thank you so much.